Good evening, members, ladies and gentlemen. And perhaps if we can deal with the issue of nominating a chair for this evening's meeting, you'll be aware that we do have a protocol which has been established for the joint scrutiny of health, a joint protocol between Cheshire and Merseyside. Under the protocol, it does say that it might be expected that consideration will be given to the chair being nominated from amongst the representatives from the lead local authority. Wirral is the lead local authority in relation to this particular matter, and at the last meeting that we had at the end of last year, Councillor McManus, who was then the chair of Wirral's Overview and Scrutiny Committee, was nominated as the chair. But obviously it is a matter for this meeting this evening, in light of the fact that Councillor McManus is no longer a member of the committee, to decide if you would like to nominate a chair and who you would like to nominate as the chair. So do we have any nominations? Nolan has been nominated. Is anybody Jet second? Yes. Okay, Councillor Lyon. Do you have any objections or anybody that wants to have a formal vote on the matter? No? Okay. Councillor Nolan.
So I work for the NHS, and my son is also employed by the NHS.
So yes, we do have observers with us this evening, councillors who have an interest by virtue of the wards they represent, so will no doubt want to contribute to this discussion this evening. So the first item is to approve the minutes, and I don't know how many people were actually present at the last meeting, because I certainly wasn't. Any of the members of this committee actually there? Not there, Chris. Any members actually there? Yes, I know. I'm going to come to you in a minute. right, so from the visiting members who are here. And the consultation process and whether or not this becomes tricky because the proposals relating to the process and resulting from the process are now public. So there is a request that we don't discuss them, which is obviously difficult because they are in the public domain, but we will do our best. And over to you, Ms.
Thank you, and thank you for the opportunity to come again. So I'll start the presentation, and Dr. Karen, when she arrives, will take over. And I apologise for those that were at the OSC, the Wirral OSC last week, because you'll be getting very much the same presentation again tonight. It was agreed with committee prior to this, so it is a strange meeting in some respects, because it is on the process of the consultation and the external review that we had, and we did explain this last week, that we were aware that by today that the papers are out in the public domain. However, we will be coming back to ask, obviously, post-governing body decision for review of that. And as if by magic, he's my colleague, Dr. Cllr. But I'll carry on with the presentation, and then Dr. Cllr can come in as well. So you'll all be aware of the background of the consultation and our context, and it was very much as it says up there, that people can't read it, but it's about getting it right for the patient, for the person. We wanted to make sure patients were getting the care that they need, making the absolute best use of our resources. There was this national request to have an urgent treatment centre, but we wanted to make sure that not just to tick the box of what the national request was, but to make sense of what that means for Wirral and the best use of that for Wirral. We also recognise, through all of the engagement work that we've done with the public over a number of years now, that there was that need for change as well, and we needed to make sure that it was sustainable, both clinically — the financial was not so much the issue, but the clinical sustainability — and also make more sense for people as well. We needed to look at how we could relieve pressure on our A&E here on Wirral, and also make it simplify the current services so that it was easier for people to understand. When you live in the NHS, it is really difficult to forget what you know and trying to be somebody that's just not aware of all of our acronyms and how we live, and if we say a word, what does that mean? Does that mean I should go there or should I go here? So we wanted to look at how we could make it as easy as possible for people to understand, and to make it standardised as well. So one of the things is that we have numerous places, and they were all called slightly different things and offered different aspects of service as well. So the engagement and the consultation that we went through, so we did an extensive pre-engagement work that we did for a number of months, and then we also, as part of the consultation, we had the public survey, we had a dedicated website, the social media campaign, we did a postcard drop throughout all of Wirral, we had all our statutory meetings, we had lots of public meetings and roadshows, and that included going over into West Cheshire as well, to make sure that we were capturing the views of people that weren't just on Wirral, that were in West Wirral, West Cheshire as well. And we also have particular focus groups with people with those protected characteristics as well. So we did quite an extensive piece of work. So going forward, the consultation process itself, so that's it's difficult for people to see it there, but we started this on the 20th of September and it's finished on the 12th of December, and that was after we issued the notification letters went to all our stakeholders, and the launch of that dedicated website with all of the consultation materials. Now, they included a read easy version, which again is going back to, you know, trying to make it easier for people to understand what we were trying to do. We had lots of informal briefings with principal, our stakeholders, and the lead clinicians and local elected members as well, and that was all prior to the launch of the consultation as well. So during the consultation, the team and numerous members of the team went out to a full range of different events and venues, and you see that we went to over 80 individual events across Wirral, And that was having focus groups, public meetings, stakeholder engagement meetings, and we also visited current urgent care locations as well, and spent some time there asking the people coming through the doors there as well for their feedback on what their views were. We also took part in local and regional media, and we tried to do that to highlight the consultation, and that postcard drop went to each of the households in Wirral as well. We also went to shopping centres that included at weekends as well, and the social media going on Facebook and Twitter as well. So we tried to use as much full range of avenues as we could to try and get out to the public. And then post-consultation, and this was a request from committee, that we engaged with an independent organisation to do that external analysis of the consultation and the feedback that we did. And that's exactly what we did. We used somebody called Hitch Marketing, and they undertook that analysis for us. So just to remind people what we went out to consult on, there were two proposals that are up there. That we asked people views on. So one was the urgent treatment centre on the Arrow Park site, which had already been decided and agreed by the governing body of the CCG. And then one was to have that for 24 hours, and then one was for 15 hours, with a range of venues and services available in the community. The walk-in centres would be limited to children, was what we went to out to. Consult with people on, and that we'd have dressing clinics as well as having additional appointments with GPs available as well. So the consultation feedback, do you want me to hand over to you at this point?
Okay.
Yes.
Can I just apologise for my tardiness? I was trying desperately to get finished seeing patients, which is what I do on a Monday and a Friday, and also navigating the geography from Easton to Wallasey at 6 o'clock on a Monday evening is slightly tricky. So again, apologies for bursting in late. You've all heard me say before that the consultation which we undertook generated quite a lot of interest and feedback, and I will continue to say that I think that's a good thing, because it demonstrates the depth of interest in the delivery of urgent care to our local community, and how passionate our population feel about the services which they utilise and the services which are available to them. And I actually applaud those who contributed and those who took part in all of the various different surveys, not only our own but the other petitions, because it's easy to criticise something, but actually to put pen to paper and to commit to that takes an awful lot more gumption, I suppose, and it means that people are really absolutely wedded to what they believe. So I applaud them for that. And the feedback we got was quite extensive. It's no guesses for really need our walk-in centres. The offers localised. This offers localised care for children, but what about everybody else? The walk-in centres are brilliant and so convenient. Other positives were the proposal is a much better idea, as it will leave A&E free to deal with just that emergencies. So we had quite a lot of extensive feedback, and as Nesta said, we went out to an independent body to analyse that, because it's really crucial that we demonstrate transparency and show that it wasn't given a CCG or a World Health and Care Commissioning flavour. It was an independent body who reviewed the feedback that we got. And as I said, there was quite extensive feedback. For the CCG survey, we had 1,965 respondents, and there were 8 other petitions then submitted with respondents from over 45,000 residents. And again, I don't need to reiterate what I said, just demonstrates the depth of feeling that people had around this. And it's really important that we got that feedback and we listen and take that on board. And I committed at a similar meeting to this in November of last year that we would listen to what our population was saying. And I won't go through all of the figures there, but you'll see there that the views and how that was broken down through the various different campaigns. But just in summarising that feedback, the consultation feedback, option one was the overall preference at 66.5%. Birkenhead residents were less likely to prefer option one, however, at 56.9%. Residents of West and South Wirral favoured option one, 75%. The proposal to offer extended GP capacity and lose some of the current walk-in centres was not popular, and I think that was something that we felt throughout the consultation, and we understood that, and when we got the feedback, we recognised that. And residents of Birkenhead and Wallasey were significantly less likely to agree with the proposal to lose some of the walk-in centre facilities. Now, I'm conscious that I'm reading one of the older slide decks, so that's later. Okay, that's okay. What did our respondents like about the options? There was some people who liked our options, I will say that. So it wasn't all negative, there was a lot of positive feedback as well. The urgent treatment centres would provide a higher level of diagnostic, and we know that because that's based on the national criteria and why we had originally agreed as a governing body to situate that at the Arrow Park site, because it has to have access to diagnostics, access to transferring patients if they become critically unwell, so they're having to have that access to the ED and to ED facilities and resource facilities is crucial. A GP-led treatment centre would provide a higher level of care to residents of Wirral. Extended access to urgent bookable appointments was something that came across very, very positively. And a consistent and standardised approach to wound care. And not just wound care, what we would want is a standardised approach to all care. We can't, and I wouldn't in any way advocate a postcode lottery. It has to be standardised, and that is crucial to what we do and what we do going forward also. Respondents disliked about our options, again, the closure of the minor injury zone and some walk-in centres, was quite evident throughout all of the feedback. And also then issues around accessing the Arrow Park site in terms of travel, cost and parking. And also then unable to make same-day appointments for dressing and wound care. That was something also that came out very strongly throughout the consultation. In terms of the location of the community hubs, during the consultation we asked the public what the most important factors were to them in terms of where those sites would be located, and three key issues came: distance from home, flexibility and convenience of appointments, and access by public transport. And that came out at a number of the meetings we attended, and that was debated at length, and I know that there's been some other meetings around that and the proposal to take that forward as we move on. The children service, the 0 to 19 service, was met with a positive response. However, the question then was asked, well, what about a mum who brings in a 2 or 3 year old child and mum is 20 or 19, how do we manage that situation? And again, that is something that we have taken on board and we recognise as being an issue, because why would we care navigate a mother away when she's got a sick child and she also needs attention? And that's crucial in how we deliver health and care to our patients and our population. It's really important that we have a holistic way and a holistic manner in which we manage people. And so that was something that did cut it quite strongly again through the consultation and in the feedback. We invited the clinical senate to come in to review our process. Now there are 13 clinical senate. Oh, I've jumped in. Is that not happening? I'll come on to the clinical senate shortly. I'll pass over to Jackie to tell you about what's changing.
Thanks, Paul. We just wanted to put this extra slide in just to refresh people from the last joint OSC that we had. Just to reassure people, these were some of the key things that we particularly took into account of the needs of Cheshire West residents who were using some of the services over in Wirral. So just pick out a few of those points really, you can't see the detail there. So when we had a look at the 17-18 data, what we found was that there were just over 3,645 visits from residents of Cheshire West, using the walk-in services over in Wirral. Not surprisingly, 51% of those visits, and just shy of 2,000, were people using the Eastern Walking Centre. But 39% were people who were actually making their way to the walking centre from the Arab Park site. And surprisingly for us, to be truthful, 10% of people were going over to use Victoria Central over in Wallasey. So there was a reasonable usage from Cheshire West. When we had a look at the breakdown, which is shared on the slide, what we saw was that the outcomes of those attendances, 26% of people were referred back to see their GP, that was appropriate to do so. 9% were redirected to A&E at Arrow Park. A lot of those were actually for fracture clinic appointments. And 21% of people were attending, of all attendances, 21% were for ongoing regular dressing need, and 21% was for paediatric activity under 19, 0 to 19. So quite an interesting range of usage. And what I appreciate, you can't see the detail on the slide at a distance, but the two boxes on the right-hand side just show you that breakdown of age group. And the bottom box also shows the top half dozen, where the people were attending from, which practice they were attending from, where they were registered within the Cheshire West area. And the red box at the bottom, that just gives the total of A&E attendances from Cheshire West at Arrow Park. So again, the same year, 17 to 18. Rural patients who were going to the Countess of Chester, 1,354. But in reverse, Cheshire West and Chester patients attending Arrow Park was 4,716. So it's really just a quick reminder snapshot of some of the activity data we took into due consideration when considering final recommendation.
Thank you, Jackie, for that. And apologies for the misalignment of the slides. Going on to the Clinical Senate review, we invited in the Clinical Senate, who are an independent group of practitioners from a widespread of allied healthcare professionals. And we invited the Senate from Greater Manchester, Lancashire and Cumbria to come and review our process. There's 13 Clinical Senates nationally, and they do exactly what I just described. They independently review processes. They don't give an opinion on what the outcomes should be. It's the process on how you get to where you are and how they cast a critical friend's eye on what's happening and give recommendations around your process. And so we felt, again, in this spirit of being very transparent and being open, that it would be useful to bring in the Clinical Senate to review the whole process. And so they came in November of last year. And four key themes came out of what they what their feedback was. Quite a lengthy document, their feedback was. But the four key themes were that they recognised that there was a need to change, and a need to change how we deliver urgent care. Without wanting to get into the confusion issue, which has been debated at length with yourselves in the past, some people don't believe that there's confusion around the service delivery. However, they did say that there were multiple levels of choice, multiple doors to press for a patient, for our population, in order to access urgent care. They felt that it was very fragmented, very silo working, not joined up as a system, and our ethos and our aims going forward, certainly under our Healthy Wirral banner, is that we will act as a system and that we will deliver health and care to our population as a system and not just honing in on one particular area. So I, as a GP, work with my colleagues in secondary care and in the community to deliver the best care we can to our population. And also it's crucial that what we deliver and how we deliver that is aligned with our strategic direction. And again, it comes back to that system-wide working across the delivery of health and care. And they came up with a number of recommendations based on those four themes that came out, and those recommendations we are processing accordingly. And if we go on to the next slide, you'll see that some of the big themes from that and the big recommendations were around technology utilisation, collaboration in our delivery of health and care, and looking at the service modelling and how we look at clinical modelling and looking at the wider clinical delivery of care, not just the more traditional doctor delivers care, but the use of the allied healthcare professionals, which is our way forward. looking at a single system and digital communication around how we can encourage patients to have to tell their story only once, the amount of times patients have to repeat the same thing over and over again and repeat the medications they're on. We're in an IT era, we're living in a digital world, why can't we ensure that that happens? And we're doing a lot of work around that with our World Care Record and Health Information Exchange. Also around shared governance and understanding and working together. And one of our key recommendations was that we host an Clinical Innovations Day for our system, and we did that on the 2nd of May of this year and have some good outputs from that also. So in terms of the key considerations from our consultation, it's important that to get across that we have heard the views of our local population and have taken that on board in terms of our consideration. People value and wish to retain all age or urgent walking access in a local way, not too far away, flexible and convenient appointments and with access to public transport. Our population strongly valued the following three locations, the Birkenhead Medical Centre, VCH and Easton, and the majority of population who completed the survey, 66.5%, preferred the option one with the 24-hour urgent treatment centre. And finally, patients value the proposal to be able to book a dressing appointment rather than having to go and wait. And that suits people's lifestyles, doesn't it? It suits their work-life balance, it suits their children, it suits whatever needs that they have. And it also suits our elderly population when we have to have somebody to bring them to that appointment. So I think it's really crucial that we recognise that we're listening to that. So in summary, the response to the consultation has been very encouraging, and I'd say it again, I think it's a good thing that we had such a response. We've heard the views of local people and are fully considering that in the recommendations. The clinical centre review, which I mentioned, and the recommendations from that are helping us as we shape things going forward. And we have had regular reviews and regular updates with West Cheshire, as well as our stakeholder group. And so finally then, in terms of next steps, obviously we're here this evening with yourselves. The recommendations will be discussed and debated at the governing body, at the Joint Strategic Commissioning Board on the 9th of July, and then it will come back to yourselves for scrutiny at a bit later in July. And so I'm happy to stop there. I obviously could talk all day about this, but I'll stop there and take any questions.
Why did you have the Senate at the point that you did, which is unusual because normally the Senate comes in to help you set up the consultation, whereas the Senate were only called once you'd agreed your consultation?
We actually had discussions with the clinical Senate from far back as May time last year, because and we had quite lengthy discussions around when they would come in and when they would review the process. And they do tend to come in at varying points throughout processes that they're invited to. So they can come in at the start, they've come in the midst, as they did with ourselves, and they've come in at the end of consultations in other areas where they've been involved. You'll remember from last summer, the date to commence the consultation was moved quite a number of times. And that was to do with logistics and the ability to ensure that everything was in place to start that consultation, recognising that it was going to be over a 12-week period. And so whilst we were teeing them up to come in, the start date had moved, and they were more than happy to fit in with what we were doing, recognising that they did come in the midst of it. They felt that their recommendations and that their feedback would have been the same regardless of at what point they came in.
Could I ask you then, why when we met with members of the Senate, did they make a particular point of raising with us the fact that they were brought in at a time which they didn't think appropriate.
Is that the meeting that we had at downstairs last year, last July? I don't recall that being what Caroline had said. She had said that they come in at varying different points, and the doctor who was representing them also concurred with that. So unless I took differently from what she said.
Can I just say that the doctor who was quite clear that they would normally have expected to come in to, I'm not saying there's anything wrong in the way he did it, but I just wondered from when they said it and made a point of raising it, because they didn't need to raise that with us, that they had been asked to come in at a separate time, and Jackie, you'll agree, it's the point I've raised a number of times, because they raised it, so I'm wondering why did they raise it?
I know, Councillor, you've raised this before. We to date have not been aware or made aware by consent of any issue. There was a little bit of a diary issue in trying to get the clinical senate all availability together, which did impact on dates available. And as Dr. Cowan has alluded to, it was also trying to make sure that we weren't cutting across local elections and herd appeals and those types of things for our consultation period. What I'm very happy to do is to go back and get a formal response from clinical senate if that will help satisfy the question that you're raising.
Thank you very much. Well done, to start with. I think the consultation that we're looking at today is really probably an exercise in what good consultation looks and feels like. However, my question is, setting the time out, you absolutely probably nailed it. The first time round, I was sitting on the scrutiny committee over in Cheshire West, and we saw the cloud go up, particularly over the decision around Easter, and that's sort of obviously what initiated the joint scrutiny. So I guess I'm sort of more interested in not what went wrong last time and what's gone right this time, but what lessons have you taken from this exercise? Because you're being scrutinised by people for whom there can never be enough community conversation or community communication, and with the greatest love and respect, health tend to come to us with lots of decisions which is based on the what, and actually we're interested in the why, primarily why is this good for me and my personal health, not good for your systems, processes, budgets, resource management things. You know, we need to start with the why rather than starting with the what. And I would hope that your consultation, which has teased out really a very commendable response from the public, shows you that you're working with the grain. People want to work with you to make this better for everybody. And please do not be frightened of engaging positively with your public, because you know they will be the best asset that you've got to work with. But I'll be interested in knowing what you've learned from version one versus the very much improved version two.
I completely concur with what you said. I think it's crucial that we engage with our population. I tend to call our population our patients, because that's how I see a lot of people when I'm in surgery. But actually, it's really important that I refer to the 300,000 and population of Wirral as our population, because they may not be patients today, but they may be tomorrow. And engagement and communication means very different things to everybody and to different people. And that's why we have to continue to strive to do better at that. And we have to continue to strive to keep open the conversations and not be afraid of the difficult conversations. I think it's really important that we recognise the lessons learned, we reflect on the lessons learned, but we utilise that going forward in how we can exact change and how we can work better in a much more integrated way. The key service users of what we do and how we deliver health and care are crucial to decision making. Of course we have to look at our budgets, of course we have to look at how we can do things within a very defined budget. I'm slightly reticent to use the cost envelope, because that expression frightens and unnerves people, but actually within the budgets that we have. So if I could offer everything to everybody, I'd be offering it 300,000 different ways and at a phenomenal cost to the Exchequer. But actually, we do have good resource, and it's how we use that wisely. And a lot of that is in conversation with our population, with our other clinicians, and with our stakeholders as to how we can take things forward. And so instead of coming with a fait accompli to be rubber stamped by the patient participation group, who will give it a tick and there's our engagement, it's about, this is our idea, can you give me some ideas as how you think we can take that forward? And engage from the start, rather than halfway through the process or at the end. And I've had this conversation with colleagues in secondary care and community care, with our local medical committee who represent GPs, and my commitment is that we'll start and we'll take this as our test bed really, and move forward with how we start to develop services and service redesign and keep people informed as we go along. Because the biggest threat is something's being done onto us and actually we haven't been involved in that process. So it's bringing people with us on that journey.
I think we're totally aligned in terms of agreeing with each other, but I do think sometimes health tends to not necessarily start with things from the sort of person perspective. Call us patients, call us problems, call us whatever you like, but you know, the things that are important to us, you know, are really what will get people communicating and conversing with you. We're the best one in the world, you know, you are all paid to manage the financial envelope. That's not my problem as a patient, but you know, being able to get somewhere with reasonable access to with a GP or a service that I would want for myself, my children and my residents is really, and you know, we all gather together around the how do we do this together, because if we'd started here with how can we absolutely make sure that we get the best community-based care that we can, and sometimes that, you know, means we have to have difficult discussions about where you might have to go to get the absolute best element of that care, you know, as opposed to we're closing that and that's best for us, we can't afford that, there's nobody that goes there. Because if I go there and I might be only one of a small number, it's very, very important to me, and I might get a petition up to.
It was in a lot of the responses, wasn't it, the anxiety about the additional GP appointments and where we get the GP appointments from. However, we have got two existing contracts with our two federations, the GP federations, who are delivering those extended hours for us as we speak. So there are additional appointments now. And on Wirral we are very lucky in that we do have a good resource there with our federations. They are able, because they work together to cover all of those extended hours that they are covered. In terms of the strategy going forward, this is again in line with the national request, so it won't just be a GP, because I know sometimes when I go, I don't want to see a GP. It might be a nurse or a first line physiotherapist or a community pharmacist I need to see. So all of this or a physician associate, which a clinician here can explain what they do, but so those extended hours will be extended from just being a GP with, actually, if that's not what you want to see, it's a wrong use of their time as well. So we are confident on Wirral as commissioners and working with our primary care providers that we are able to meet all of those requests for additional appointments.
So does that mean your recruitment is very healthy?
Yes.
It might be worth just adding a little bit in. Obviously, we're not here about the decision tonight, it's about the process. But as Nestor alluded to, as those conversations and plans with primary care have evolved, the final position we have completely taken into account in our final recommendation with what the model is going forward. I know we're not into that detail tonight, but you'll see that, that working in the papers that have been put on the website, and we can discuss that decision making in July, the scrutiny session in July. The other point you made was about out of hours, and out of hours was technically out of the immediate scope that was agreed at the start of this piece of work. But we're very mindful that as we move forward with the implementation of an urgent treatment centre and the extended access appointments, as those are well embedded, we will be looking with colleagues, providers, primary care, at the out of hours service as part of that. So that's in our sights, and we'll discuss that with providers to take forward.
Sorry, can I just follow up with one more supplementary and along the lines of where you're going in terms of future? And that is, in terms of new build, increasing demand, I suspect that, like Cheshire, West of Cheshire, there's a huge increase in housing development. How do your plans as they are now, how are they going to account for future growth in housing?
Okay, it's very much a moving feast, so we need to keep our eyes open. We have had conversations during this process, and we will continue to do so with housing colleagues from the council. I've certainly met with David Ball on several occasions to look at the plan, the housing plan for Wirral, and any impacts, and clearly that would be part of any healthy Wirral conversation. So we've had initial discussions, made sure that our assumptions for this proposal don't have any immediate red lights, so to speak, but we'll continue those conversations going forward.
The provision of general practice in Wirral is thankfully very healthy, and unlike other areas nationally where there's a struggle to recruit and retain GPs, we thankfully haven't had that issue as of yet. We do have quite a significant number of GPs who are approaching retirement age, but because Wirral is very strongly populated with teaching practices, where GP registrars will train throughout their GP training, so they will be assigned to a practice or maybe a number of practices and then do their last year in one particular practice. Because we have a lot of training practices throughout Wirral, we do have quite a strong retention of GPs who train within Wirral and then thankfully tend to stay. So we haven't had the issue that's been recognised nationally. Say that with the caveat as of yet, but we do have a lot of new doctors coming along. But I think it's important to recognise that the delivery of general practice is evolving, and so the traditional model of the GP working 10 sessions, so 5 full days a week and on the weekends, has evolved.